Good morning. Merry Christmas. Nice to be here with you all today to celebrate the birth of our Savior. You know, God, ever since the fall into sin, God had his plan. He had his plan, his solution to that sin, and that was to send us our substitute, to send us our Savior, Jesus. And here we are today, 2,000 years after the birth of our Savior, to celebrate the fact that God came through on his promises. And that's the what we get to celebrate, that God keeps his promises to us, the promise of forgiveness, the promise, pledge of our life with him forever because of Jesus and because of his birth. And so I'm so glad to see you here today and to be able to celebrate that with you, the birth of our Savior. We'll begin our worship with our opening hymn, O Come All Ye Faithful. May God bless our worship here in his house today. In the name of the Father who sent his Son to dwell among us, in the name of Jesus Emmanuel, God with us, in the name of the Holy Spirit by whose power Jesus was conceived and who dwells in our hearts, amen. The Word has become flesh, has come to dwell among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father full of grace and truth. Therefore, let us worship him in spirit and in truth. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sin to God, our Heavenly Father, and ask for His forgiveness. Almighty God, merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful. I have disobeyed you by what I have done, and by I have failed to do each day. For this, I justly deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for the evil I have thought, spoken, and done. And for the sake of my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. The Christ child, conceived of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, is indeed the Son of God and Savior of the world. In him and through his death on the cross, we have forgiveness of sins, life, and eternal salvation. With this Spirit-worked confidence, we can joyfully serve our God all our days with the blessed hope of eternal life. Amen. In the peace of forgiveness, we lift our voices in praise to the Lord. In Christ, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, grant that the birth of your only Son in the flesh may set us free from our old bondage under the yoke of sin. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first lesson is taken from the scroll of Isaiah chapter 9. 700 years before the birth of Jesus Christ, Isaiah prophesied his coming. Isaiah writes to us this Christmas Eve, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the days of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." This is the word of our God. We join in singing our next hymn, "Now Sing, We Now Rejoice." Our second lesson is taken from Paul's letter to Titus, chapter 2. What's something you're hoping for Christmas? What's a present you hope you get? You got one? You got one? Or did you already open up your presents? Did you open them up already? Okay. What do you hope you're going to get? You just made mom and dad's job easier. You don't need anything. That's great. That's wonderful. What are you hoping for? What are you hoping for Christmas?
Jesus.
There you go, Brantley. He said Jesus. My man, my man. He knows it all too well. What are you hoping for Christmas?
Jesus.
Yes. Perfect. Amen. Go home. You're good. What's something you hope for? You have that. You kiddos, you hope for something for Christmas, right? But you don't know if you're going to get it. You're not quite sure. You're not really sure. The interesting thing about the Bible, when it uses the word hope, it doesn't have like this element of uncertainty. It's a sure thing. Like when you say, like if I said, I hope to go home and open Christmas presents tomorrow, is that going to happen? That's going to happen, right? Yeah, you know that's going to happen. So it's not like, but you don't know what you're exactly going to get. So when the Bible talks about us having hope because of Jesus, it's this promise of something we look forward to getting. And that's what Paul talks about here, this hope that we have because of Christ. Titus chapter 2. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself to us to redeem us all from wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. This is God's word. We join in our hymn response, Joy Has Dawned. Stand for the reading of the gospel. The holy gospel for us this Christmas Eve is taken from the gospel of St. Luke, chapter 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the gospel of Christ, our King. We join in our confession of faith. Why do I believe that Jesus Christ is true God? Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. Why do I believe that Jesus Christ is true man? There is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is true God and true man because the Bible calls him God and man. Why do I believe that Jesus Christ is true God? Jesus was with God in the beginning. Why do I believe that Jesus Christ is true man? You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. I believe that Jesus Christ is true God and true man because he has godly and human characteristics. Why do I believe that Jesus Christ is true God? The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Why do I believe that Jesus Christ is true man? Jesus wept. I believe that Jesus Christ is true God and true man because he did godly and human actions. Why was it necessary that Jesus be both true man and true God? God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under law, to redeem those under law. It was necessary that Jesus be both true man and true God in one person so that he could, under God's law, and keep it perfectly for me. It was also necessary that Jesus be both true man and true God in one person so that he could die and also ransom me by his death. You may be seated, and we will hear the children's choir. Stay up for the children's message, yeah. Yep. You want to move your bag so Jasmine can sit there? Thank you. Awesome. All right, you guys know what day it is? Yeah, it's Christmas Eve. We've been waiting for this day. Who's excited for today? Oh, okay, I knew you guys would be, yeah. Because what's Christmas all about? Yes, that's right, it's all about Jesus. They beat you to the punch before you could even say it, my man. Yeah, it's all about Jesus, yeah. Sometimes when we talk about Christmas, we talk about it's about giving, but it's actually all about receiving. It's all about receiving. And that's not selfish. Because what do we receive at Christmas? Jesus, yes, we receive presents, we receive the gift of Jesus. Because Jesus came as a little baby, he came to live for you, he came to die for you, he came to do all that for you so that way you could go to heaven. So remember that when you're getting Christmas presents around the tree, remember the greatest gift of all that you've been given Jesus, yes. And that's the reason we celebrate Christmas, because we've been given the gift of our Savior Jesus. Let's pray, okay? Let's fold our hands. Dear Jesus, thank you for coming to take away all of my sins. Help me celebrate that today and every day, and let me share that gift with everybody I meet. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. All right, you guys can go sit back down. Thanks for singing this morning. You guys can go sit back down with your parents, and we'll continue our service with the next hymn, Go Tell It on the Mountain. Mercy and peace are yours in abundance through Jesus Christ, our Savior, our King. Amen. The words for our consideration are taken from Luke's Gospel, chapter 2. Luke records for us, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.'" This is God's word. Please bow your heads and join me in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Friends, there's a pretty common expression, and I'm sure you could probably finish it for me. Man plans, but God laughs. Right? And that expression has been reiterated and rephrased and repackaged. Everybody from legendary basketball coach John Wooden to ex-president Barack Obama have said that in some form of a speech or whatnot. But Solomon was actually the one who originated the sentiment. He said in Proverbs, "In their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps." What's the sentiment? We plan, we prep, we lay everything out in a timeline, we know how everything is supposed to be, we know how it's all supposed to go, and then what happens? We get sideswiped, we get blindsided, all of a sudden some variable that we weren't accounting for pops up, and all of our plans, all of our perfectly meticulous way things were supposed to go, get completely thrown out the window. I'm sure, like any parent-to-be, Mary and Joseph had their plans. They were prepping for that baby to come. You know, Joseph probably put his carpentry skills to work. He crafted this beautiful bassinet. He was showcasing it to all his buddies. "Hey, fellas, check out what I made in the shop. Check it out. It's pretty neat, pretty slick, what I got here." You know, Mary, maybe some of her lady friends threw her a baby shower. I don't know if they did that in Jewish culture 2,000 years ago. But something similar to that, right? Where experienced veteran mothers probably brought their homemade remedies of their lotions and their oils and their powders that could rid any rash from baby Jesus' little baby bottom. Right? And they had everything all set, all the diapers and all the onesies and all the aloes, and the nursery was all set, and the home was all baby-proof there in Nazareth. Everything was all set, ready to go, just like all of you did when you had your first child. They had everything all set for that baby. You just needed to wait for that baby to come, right? As Solomon said, in their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps. Or as later authors would say, man plans but God laughs. Seemingly, a monkey wrench got thrown into all those well thought out plans for baby Jesus' birth, didn't it? What happened? In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. Well, governments do what governments always love to do. They love to count their people so they can tax their people. And what happened? Joseph and Mary, they had to scrap their plans for baby Jesus' birth there in Nazareth. They had to haul themselves 70 miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem. Ladies, again, imagine this being full term, a nice donkey ride through the Judean countryside, 70 miles to Bethlehem, and you got to make their way there. That nursery, that plan of everything there in Nazareth would have to wait. That little nursery, that bassinet, that beautiful olive wood bassinet would have to be put on hold. And they make their way again, and man plans, but God laughs. What happened? They get to Bethlehem, and everything is all booked up. There's not a guest room to be found. No one can squeeze them in a nook or a cranny anywhere. There's no air mattresses. There's nothing. Nothing to be found, no place for them to go except for, well, this stable. You can go into the barn. Can't you just picture Joseph kicking himself? "Oh, if only we had left a few days earlier like I wanted, we'd been able to find a place." I'm sure Mary had to stop a few times, you know, being full term, had to stop like pregnant women do when they travel, had to stop a few times more than they normally would. They get there, and can't you see Mary and Joseph just both kind of looking up into the heavens and going, "Really, Lord, this is where you want your son, our Savior of the world, to be born in this stall next to the cows with this manger, this feeding trough for his bed?" Again, man plans, but God laughs, or as Solomon said, in their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps. Why did God have it all play out like this? Why wasn't he born up in Nazareth? Why wasn't that wonderful nursery made use? Why have it all happened like this? Well, Luke tells us that in the gospel for this morning. You see, there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby of Bethlehem, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, over in Bethlehem, a child is born to you. He is Christ the Lord." What's the next line? "This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." All of a sudden, the glory of God shines over those hills of Bethlehem. And this angelic chorus announces to the people, "The Savior has been born to you. The Savior, the promised Prince of Peace, the one long foretold." God had made hundreds of prophecies to his people, promising them, pledging to them a Savior, a Messiah would come. And the people longed for that Messiah. They waited for that Messiah for years and years and years. Generation after generation, they were longing for this promised Prince of Peace, this promised Savior. And there, 2,000 years ago in Bethlehem, angels announced to shepherds, "He's here. The one that God has promised to deliver peace has now been born to you." Now, I'm guessing shepherds were like most guys are today. Guys, you can relate to this. Somebody, you'll get a phone call or something about some relative or some family friend has a baby. And your wife will say to you, "So, what's his name?" And you might remember the name. You might remember if it was a boy or a girl. "How long was he?" "I don't know." "How heavy is he?" "I don't know." "Does he have hair or is he curls? What color is his hair?" I don't know. You know, newborn babies, they all look exactly the same. They do. They have that smushed old man face, and they all look the same. They all look the same. "This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger? In a feeding trough for cows? Certainly would be a sight." You see, the shepherds, they raced into Bethlehem. And they went searching for this child. And there was no mistake. It was this child. This child was the one that God had promised. This child was the one that God had pledged. This child was the one that God had planned for the world. This one right here. Man plans, but God laughs, or as Solomon put it, in their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps. I would guess if your year went kind of like mine, there were things that happened in 2023 that did not go according to plan. How many of you had a year like that? You had things that you lined up, things that you all thought were going to happen, steps that you had all set in place, and then what happened? You got sideswiped. You got blindsided. The promotion didn't go like you thought it would. The doctor visit didn't go like you thought it would. That conversation didn't happen like you thought it would. Something else totally took over. And without a doubt, 2024 is going to be very, very similar. We can make our plans. We can make our preparations. We can think how things are all going to play out. But God has a plan. This Christmas, I want you to celebrate that in your homes and in your lives. As you look at what's happening in your world, everything in your sphere of influence, or as you look what's happening in the country or around the globe, understand and take comfort that your God most certainly has a plan. Most certainly has a plan. Think of this. From the time our first parents fell into sin, since Adam and Eve there in the garden, God pledged to them a solution to sin and death. And he laid that all out. He laid out all the groundwork. And he continued that promise to the next generation after the next generation, to Abraham and Isaac. He promised them too. a Savior would come from their line. And through Isaiah, he foretold them a mighty counselor, a prince of peace. And through Micah, he said, a Savior is coming, born in Bethlehem, a Savior for you. And if God has promised and God has planned out your salvation, has promised and pledged out your eternity in heaven with him, he's got a plan for you tomorrow. So I wish you God's richest blessings this Christmas as you celebrate the fact that God has a plan for you and your God loves you. If you're visiting here with us today, we're so excited that you're here. And it is our plan, it's our intention to continue to preach this good news of our salvation and the peace that Jesus brings. And I hope, I pray that God brings you that peace this Christmas. And I hope that you'll join us in the new year as well as you continue to celebrate the birth of our Savior. So Merry Christmas. God bless. With that, all God's people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. May the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. At this time, we have opportunity to bring our offerings of thanks to the Lord. Ushers are going to be coming down the aisle with baskets if you'd like to do that. Otherwise, you can go to the church website and give online. If you are visiting here with us today, and there's a lot of visitors, this is amazing. So we're so glad that you're here, that you took time to be here with us today. If you are visiting here with us today, if you wouldn't mind just scanning the QR code that's on page 12 in the worship folder. If you're joining us online, please be sure to give our video a like. Share this video with someone who could hear the peace of Jesus Christ today. With that, then, bring our offerings of thanks. Continue our service with prayer. Eternal Father, throughout the centuries, you repeated and affirmed your promise to send the offspring of the woman to crush the serpent's head. Through your prophets of old, you continually directed the eyes of your people to the coming of their Savior. We praise you, Lord, for keeping your promise and sending us Jesus to destroy the works of death and the devil. We celebrate the birth of our Savior with word and sacrament. Use that word and sacrament to shatter our pride and to rouse us from spiritual slumber and apathy. You sent us your Son to buy us back from sin and death. Let this good news be our joy and our strength as we end 2023 and as we begin a new year. Bless us, Lord, as you use us as your vessels to cheer the lonely and to encourage the fearful, to give hope to the despairing with that gospel message of Jesus' love and his promise of salvation. Fill our lives with the message of your peace and the music of your grace. Hear us, Lord, also as we bring you our private petitions in silent prayer. Bless our family, our friends, our community with the news of Jesus' birth. Fill our hearts with hope and peace. It's in his name we pray. Amen. We join in singing the Lord's Prayer. Be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Through his holy prophets he promised a king to bring light to those living in darkness and in the shadow of death. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. The supper is now ready. I invite the communicant members at peace to come forward. If you're visiting with us here and you're unfamiliar with our communion practices, please speak with me after the service. I'd love to tell you more about that. But otherwise, Lord, bless your communion. Please stand for closing prayer and blessing. Oh Lord, our Heavenly Father, we praise you for the gifts of forgiveness, life, and salvation that we have received through the very body and blood of your gift of love, Jesus Christ, our Lord. You have proclaimed to us once again this morning the joyful good news of the birth of your Son. We give you praise for the gift of the world's redemption, for the gift of eternal peace, and for the gift of joy in the Holy Spirit. Preserve these treasures in our hearts and minds until we finally come to share your eternal glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated for our closing hymn. Christmas. It's so nice to be here with you all here today. Again, a warm welcome to our guests, our visitors. I'm so glad that you took a chance and decided to try something different, something new, and joining us here at Peace. You're always more than welcome. I hope you'll stick around and visit with some people. Again, if you see some unfamiliar faces, be sure to introduce yourself, say hello, welcome people. If you're family and friends visiting, some family and friends of Peace, welcome. Safe travels if you are traveling here today or during the holiday season. A couple things I wanted to point out. Tonight, there will be a Christmas service, a service of lessons and carols that'll be at 6 o'clock, again, back here in the tent. It will be a completely different service. Well, not completely. It's still Christmas, but you know what I mean. It's a different service. You're more than welcome to join us for that. And then today is the deadline. If you have not let me know for the Men of His Word Conference. If you're planning on doing that, please let me know that by today. Shoot me a text, speak to me verbally, send me an email, give me a phone call. Let me know by today if you're planning on attending that. And then Phil and Sue Fife are going to be hosting a bonfire at their house on New Year's Eve. There's an announcement for that in the worship folder. So if you're interested in going to some fireside fellowship at the Fifes, good alliteration there. If you're interested in doing that, there's information about that for New Year's Eve. Any other announcements? Adult choir that is singing tonight. Where's Kim? You're meeting in the ministry center right after service to do a run through for the choir piece for tonight. Otherwise, there's snacks. Donna told me there's good Wisconsin cheese curds in the back, so stick around. If that doesn't get you to stick around for snacks, I don't know what will. But otherwise, wish you God's richest blessings. Merry, Merry Christmas, and be sure to say hi to somebody you haven't met yet. So Merry Christmas, and we'll see you later. Thank you.